Okay.
But you know, as long as we are saying that we're gonna have situations where we're not gonna be in agreement with those, as long as you say the walking victory, you're gonna have disagreement. So that, you know, that piece of separation there is not gonna ever be solved. So what you have to show is that, well, if I'm gonna win this person, then I have to befriend them without becoming a sinner. And that's the challenge is not overcoming what we disagree about. The challenge is trying to win that person and you not getting in sin to win it. Now that's what Jesus did. I mean, he didn't bow down to them, but he did win them over, the ones that he could, without becoming a sinner. So how, now, what we're trying to do is keep our mindset that this is my lifestyle, this is my mindset, and this is my philosophy for living. So I'm not going to give that up to win you, but now, a perfect example is that that last holiday, my family and I was at a house, and they had a whole bunch of meat cooked. Some of my younger members in the Lord, family members, let the host know that I don't eat that kind of meat anymore. And at the end of the deal, we had to take, the host asked people to take some of this meat home because there was so much of it left. And I said, sure, I'll take some. There was a whole slab of ribs, which I don't do pork, but I didn't let that host know that I was going to report, but I took it to let them know that I don't want nothing in the way that they think they're different, they think they're something, because I don't know what it is. We all came up eating this. So what is it with them? So to kill that, I said, okay, I'll take some. And what I did, I took it and sent it to my dog. but in front of that person, I did not want to say that, no, I don't want it in. I declined it because that would have created a deal. Now, sure, I was raised on pork, but I made a choice not to eat it now. And when I took it home and kept it in my refrigerator for a couple of days, I said, well, you know, I'm just kidding. No, but they don't know that. But it kept, so some things we have to do, like be wise and not allow that kind of stuff to get in the way.
Yeah. Okay, that's good. The scripture says that don't be overcome evil with good. And Brother Holman spoke good too, because humility means to withdraw from your own way and yield to God's way. So God's way is to not to be overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. So if we follow the example of Jesus, right, so sometimes it might require just simply ignoring.
There's no cut and dry way.
Right.
Yeah, it depends on the situation. Mm-hmm. And if you're in the presence, and you know you have to go in the presence of those people, it's a family reunion, say. You know, Bubba's going to be there. You know how Bubba acts. So we want to try to avoid it with the community. But if Bubba says something to you, you just kind of be nice to him and go on. That doesn't mean that all the year you have tea and crumpets with him. You know, you're going to see him once a year at that little town. Just greet him, treat him cordially.
Yeah, just pray in the spirit before you go. Be full of the word. Amen. I think that you'll be able to survive. Right, Brother Curtis, you about to say something? He's always around big events like that.
I've learned over the years that when someone comes and attacks me for being a Christian, that they're really trying to make me angry, or start an argument, or want to see my reaction.
Right.
So over the years, I've learned to just prove myself that to them that I am a Christian, that I believe in what I'm living, and this life is what I'm living and not what I'm practicing.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of times you may have a remark to say to them, but let it die down with them always having the last word, and eventually you win them over. I mean, over the years, a lot of the guys that used to come to me, oh man, it ain't gonna last. Oh, I know you better than that. I don't know what. You know, they say a lot of negative stuff to me, and they watch me.
So it's your action.
Yes, and I knew they was watching me. So I would pray. When I knew I was going to go around, I fast. I fast and Lord, give me the strength to overwin them this time. And it works.
Right.
Yeah, it works.
All right. So you have to draw from strength from
fasting and praying.
All right. Amen. So if you get prepared, build yourself up. Amen. On your most holy faith by praying in the Holy Ghost. If you get those kind of instances, you have to go in there prepared. You have to go actually in the Spirit. And I think that if you stay in the Spirit and respond from the Spirit, I think that everything will work itself out. Okay, I want to go to the third thing that we want to make. Repetitious information. The environment plays a big role in how we believe. Also, credible authority figures. So once we get saved, we know that we don't take everybody at their word. Our authority becomes the Word of God. You know, we begin to get into the Word of God and begin to meditate the Word of God. We begin to expose ourselves to teaching and to preaching. And so we get established in the Word of God, and the Word of God becomes our highest source of authority. So everything has to change around. Once you come into the kingdom of God, it's a new environment. You got to get into a new environment, and you really got to make the Word of God the highest source of what? Authority. Amen. You can't take grandma, grandfather, and what your preacher said years ago. You can't really rely on that. You have to, the Bible says, if ye continue in my word, ye shall know the what? Truth. And the truth shall set you free. So our focus should be on finding what? The truth. Getting into the word and getting established in the word of God. And then the word of God becomes our credible authority. And we will always come out good when the word of God is our guide. All right? Repetitious information, where information is fed to us over and over again. So this is how repetitious information gets embedded into our subconscious mind. Everybody will agree with this. Information that we hear over and over, whether it's TV, whether it's radio, whether it's newspaper, okay, it has a real impact on your believing and how you think. So you have to be able to control what comes in, what you will expose yourself to, and what you will permit your ears to hear and your spirit and your heart to receive. Because repetitious information can actually, amen, really begin to what? Dominate your what? Your mind. If you hear things over and over and over and over, amen, more than likely, you're going to what? Find yourself singing that song. All right? You're going to begin to what? See images of those things that you are what? Hearing repeatedly. So you're going to begin to be controlled and ruled by the things that you are hearing over and over. So repetitious information is one of the main ways that our belief systems are shaped. And when we get into the kingdom of God, there are some repetitious things that we need to do in the kingdom of God. And the thing that we need to do when we come into the kingdom of God is that we need to go to Joshua, what's that? 1:8. Amen. So we need to focus on the Word of God and begin to repetitiously program the Word of God into our what? Mind and into our spirit. Now that's very important that we program the Word of God into our minds and into our system, because I have here some things that I wanted to share with you. We call this meditation. Let's look at Joshua 1:8. Once we are born spiritually, when we are born into the kingdom, the focus should be primarily receiving the Word of God. The scripture says, receive ye the engrafted word of God, which is able to what? Save your soul. In other words, to change the way that you think. Okay, you change the way you think by receiving the engrafted word of God. So the word of God has to be established, it has to be received, it has to be imparted into our old belief system. Amen. And once we begin to program, once we begin to feed on the word of God, once we begin to confess and verbalize the word of God, then the process of renewing the mind begins to take place. In other words, things that's been embedded in us for many, many years are going to gradually begin to be uprooted, and they're going to lose their grip over the way that you're thinking and the way that you're believing. But it's going to be a process. Renewing of the mind does not happen overnight. All right, so verbalization or releasing words helps to produce the faith for the things you are saying. All right, so the process of releasing words, the word of God, is the way that the faith process actually begins. I think that we all understand that the first thing that we do when we believe, Scripture says in Romans 10, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall what? Believe in thine heart that what? God raised him from the dead, thou shalt what? Be saved. All right, the first act of faith that you engage in after you believe is that you will what? Make a confession. You will release words that will project the thing that you will believe in. Releasing words is very, very important to the faith process. Because when you release words, what you're saying, you are putting those words out there, and those words that you are speaking are designed to what? Get into your what? Mind. In other words, you begin to what? Think differently, because the words that you are speaking are going to demand that your thinking will what? Begin to what? Change. Amen. So how do you change the way you think? Amen. You got to begin with what? Speaking the right words. Amen. Because the words that you speak out of your mouth will eventually get into your what? Your heart, your spirit. But it doesn't get in there real quick all the time. Is that right? It's a long, drawn out process. Amen. You have to speak it and what? Keep on. It's repetition. You got to what? Keep on. Keep on. Amen. Praise God. Keep on speaking it. All right. So I'm just going to give you just a few notes here. The words you speak produce the faith for the things you are saying. The words you speak produce the faith for the things you are saying. So when we said meditate day and night, that means that words has to be released. You got to verbalize it. All right. Also, you got to what? Visualize it. Visualize it, right? And then you have to internalize it. I'll kind of break this down as we go. Okay? Speaking the word out of your mouth is what gets the word in your heart. Amen? And cause faith to come. Speaking the word out of your mouth is what gets the word in your heart and cause faith to come. See, sometimes we don't connect the relationship between the words that we are speaking to the development of our faith. Okay, but words coming out of your mouth is what gets the word in your heart. Faith comes by what? Hearing. All right, so sometimes you have to speak the word for a period of time, because whatever has been programmed into our subconscious, whatever has become preeminent, that is deeply, deeply what? Embedded into our what? Into our subconscious mind. In order to purge our subconscious mind of a whole lot of things that have been programmed through environment. God knows we've gone through many, many years of that. You've been subjected to all types of environments and peoples and conditions and authority figures. It's not just going to happen overnight, and you shouldn't get discouraged because your faith is not going to be what it wants to, what you want it to be after confessing the Word of God for a few days. You ought not to be discouraged. Amen. Because it took what? It took you, how old are we now? We in our 20s? Anybody in their 20s? 30s? 40s? 50s? Everybody ain't been saved all your life, right? How many been saved 20 years? How many been saved at least 20 years? Right? 30 years. 40 years. Well, all of us got a past, all of us got a history, amen, before we got saved. All right, now, let me just read this. First, words create images, so when we speak what God's Word says about our circumstances and situations, we are able to get a mental picture of what the will of God is for us. I'm going to read that again. Words create what? Images. You know, we mentioned that you verbalize it, you got to what? Say it. You got to get those words out there and get those words what? Working for you. But words create what? Images. And when the words create images, then pictures begin to what? Form. Amen. God's Word says that what God's Word says about our circumstances and situations begins to be projected, and we're able to get a mental picture of what the will of God is for us. Amen. Second, to speak faith-filled words releases faith into the situation and triggers the creative and the supernatural power of God. See, words create pictures and images of the things that we are what? Believing for, whatever God's will for us to be. You can begin to see what? The end results of what God has what? Will or design for your life. So when we say you have to see the end results from the beginning, that means that this is what the process of meditation will do. But it starts with releasing what? Words. You have to come into agreement and what? Say what God says about your situation, about your circumstances, about whatever you are trying to change and whatever you are trying to believe. Amen. Now, faith, as I said again, releases, words releases faith into the situation and triggers the creative and the supernatural power of God. To speak faith-filled words, you release faith into the what? Situation, and triggers the what? Creative and the supernatural power of God. Alright, so that's how your subconscious mind begins to be what? Impacted. It takes the supernatural power of God to get out of you all of that mess that you have what? Fed on, you've heard repeatedly for years and years, all of the examples you've seen before you, all of the words and situations that you have been around for all of your life. It takes the supernatural power of God. So you got to begin to what? Amen. Get those words out there. Amen. Greater is he that is in me than what? He that is in the world. Amen. Satan's dominion over my life is what? Broken. I've been delivered from what? The power of darkness. Everybody can say words like that. I've been what? Delivered. Amen. See, sometimes when we tell you that the importance of confession, sometimes we don't understand why we need to do it. We need to uproot a whole lot of that what? Unbelief. All of that what? Stuff that we have what? Programmed into our system that keeps us what? Limited, amen, as far, amen, in terms of how high we can go in the Lord, what we can actually accomplish in life, because sometimes our believing is so messed up until you just can't go beyond a certain what level.
Bubba comes to the reunion or something, and say, you know, you believe in for health, a job.
Right.
And he tells you on that principle that that's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Then can we come back and say, well, it's the same way that you receive salvation.
Mm-hmm.
Can you point, elaborate on that? Because, you know, like Romans 10, 9 and 10, because we can't get saved until mm-hmm. we believe it and see. A lot of people, they don't know, even if they're saved right now, to even believe into to another one.
Right, so salvation is contingent upon not only believing, you got to what? Believe, and then you got to what? You got to act. You got to believe. See, believing is no more than an accumulation of what? Knowledge. When you read the Bible, you get what? Knowledge and information. And after so long, you're going to come up with what? A belief system that you will begin to what? Adopt, begin to live by, or govern your life by. But it's through an accumulation of what? Knowledge. See here? You've got all this information here on faith. Now, when you go through all this information, you're definitely going to come up with what? A system of what? Beliefs that will govern or control your life. Okay, but the way that you release that belief, see, faith is acting on what you believe. Everybody agree? Faith is what? Believing alone will not what? Cause any change or transformation. You can believe all you want in, amen, praise God, in God, but unless you what? Confess Him.
And then act on it.
And act on it or accept Him as Lord and Savior, it's not going to do you what? Any good. Okay, so the first way you act on your faith after you believe is you confess, you say it. That's the first thing, and that's acting, but it's not doing anything physically, but it's action. Okay, so when you say, I believe that Jesus died for me. I believe that He rose again, and because He died and rose again on the basis of what He did through His life, His death and resurrection, amen, I am saved and I am delivered from the power of sin. When you say that, then that clinches or releases your what? Belief, and that belief begins to what? Manifest, and many times the joy is released and the power of the anointing of God is released, and you get the what? Deliverance and the release of your spirit, and the power of God begins to indwell your spirit. Okay, so it is acting on what you believe that really causes faith to work. You got to act on what you believe. Now, let me just say this.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
The steps that you enumerated, mm-hmm. which one would you say is the most challenging?
What step? Environmental?
No. Believing, confessing, then acting on it.
All right, Sister Hill has the question. She says that which is the most challenging? Believing, establishing your beliefs
right.
through information,
confessing.
Or confessing the word.
Or acting upon it. And of course, we know inherent and in the process is acting, but mm-hmm. when it comes to really implementing,
okay.
Yes, okay. Which of it, looking at that process, which would you say is the most challenging?
All right. Anybody want to respond to her? Which one is the most challenging? The believing part? Or the confessing part.
The
acting after the confession.
Yeah.
Corresponding actions after you have confessed. Okay, which y'all feel like is most challenging? Okay. Well, that's a good question. Which is the most vital? Which is the most challenging?
I would say the acting, because the acting actually demonstrates your
faith, and which would could bring the results of what you're believing. So by acting, you know, you can demonstrate that you love somebody by showing. You can say you show them, or you can say, I believe I'll show you, but action is the manifestation of actually your belief.
All right, anybody else?
Can't act unless you believe.
All right, somebody said you can't act unless you believe.
Now that's true.
You can act and act and unbelieve, can't you?
Yes, you can.
Actually,
I
believe.
Yeah, but you can also believe, don't matter.
No,
that's true.
Yeah.
I think it's pretty hard to believe. Maybe I should have answered the question.
Okay. All right. So.
I believe it's almost impossible.
All right, Sister Dorothy, say it's.
It's hard to believe.
Hard to believe and not act.
If you really believe, I don't see how.
A lot of believing and no act.
I don't see how.
Things would be a lot different.
Right, you can have give mental assent, the head knowledge,
but it's not believing.
Yeah,
I'm gonna believe it. I believe it. I understand it, but I might not act on it. If I have a challenge, my first inclination probably would not go to that.
I look at it like this. It all coincides with each other, but it all based on that individual. Some might believe, some might not have action, some might have action. So I just look at it, it all depends on that individual. Because like I said, everybody have their own belief about something, whether it's action or love, or faith or whatever. So it's based on that individual. So.
All right, Brother Pierce has a good observation.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. Mm-hmm. We don't have time though. What that would help to crystallize is we came up, presented a scenario, and then have us to walk through those steps to see a scenario of, okay, some situation, and then say, what would you do in that situation? When you walk through that, I think it can help us to dissect.
Okay, well, next week.
But we don't have time.
Next week, you bring that back to us, all right? Work it out.
Praise God.
Okay, let me read this. 2 Corinthians 4. It says, 2 Corinthians 4:13, we have in the same spirit of faith according as it is written, I believe.
I'm sorry.
And therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak. Okay, this is 2 Corinthians 4:13. We have in the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore speak. Okay, the spirit of faith says this, when we believe, we will what? Speak. When we have actually believed, amen, in the spirit realm, amen, the spirit of faith says that when you actually believe, you're going to what? You're going to speak. And therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore what? Speak. Okay. All right, I'm going to read this. This is all the time that we're going to have. See if everybody agrees with this. How much time do we have? Okay, the first stage of meditation process, which is speaking forth the word of God to get it into your heart. I want you to follow me. The first stage of the meditation process, which is speaking the word of God to get it into your heart, does very little to affect change initially in your circumstances. I'm going to read that again. Speaking forth the word of God in order to get it into your heart, it does very little, OK? Okay, the reason why it does very little, you're dealing with a what? A big mountain. You're trying to what? You're trying to uproot a whole lot of things that have taken place in your environment, also credible authority figures. Number three, repetitious information. All of that has been programmed into you many, many, many years. Okay, so when you first began to speak the word of God in order to get it into your heart, it's not going to do a whole lot to do that initially. Very little change you're going to what? Witness initially. All right? Now, it is affecting, okay, what the word of God is doing, and everybody needs to know this, what the word of God is doing when you begin to speak it, when you begin to come into agreement with it, you begin to confess it, is doing very little to change your circumstances or the things that you are believing for at that particular point. But what it is doing, it is affecting change in you. It is affecting change in you. Maybe not your circumstances, but it's actually what? Affecting change in you. It's changing you on the inside. Amen. Because your thinking is not going to be impacted until you can see yourself different on the inside. See, your thinking reflects how you see yourself on the inside. And how many remembers when the spies were sent over to the promised land to spy out the land? And 10 of them came back with what kind of report? All right. 2 of them came back with what kind of report? All right. How did the 10 spies see themselves? They saw themselves as being what? Incapable. They said, we're just like what? Grasshoppers in their sight. We're not able to what? Go against all of these people. All right, so they saw themselves as being what? Inferior to their enemies. So their thinking reflected how they saw themselves what? On the inside, amen, and their believing was that what? We are not able, we are not capable, we are not strong enough. All right, so we got to what? Change the way that we see ourselves on the what? Inside. Amen. Bible can say all day, greater is he that is in me. Amen. Than he that is in the world. Amen. We can repeat that, you know, many times. That's a powerful saying. Greater is he that is in me. But that's not going to what? Kick in immediately. Amen. Because it's going to what? Take a while for that word of God to what? Penetrate your what? Your inside to impact how you see yourself on the inside. Amen. Praise God. But I believe that if you keep speaking these things, greater is he. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Great peace have they that love your law. Amen. Begin to agree with the word of God. Little by little, something on the inside of you is going to begin to what? Rise up. Amen. Amen. It's going to take place, but it's not going to be overnight. Alright? It's affecting change in you. It's changing you on the inside. It's deprogramming. See, I want y'all to be encouraged. Amen. When we give you these handouts, some of y'all say, well, Pastor Hill always giving us something to, amen, to keep us busy. And how many of y'all know what these are? Yeah. All right, just says, speak out God's word. I mean, that's a lot of good scriptures. And then, following that set of scriptures, we have, okay, watch this. Praise God for what you are believing for. See, as you begin to speak God's word out, then images and pictures begin to what? Form as to what? Amen. As to what God is saying about you. You begin to see yourself as what? God, what? Sees you on the inside. You begin to see yourself not just a little poor, person, up and down, in and out, weak knee, jelly back, you begin to see yourself as what God sees you, but it begins when you begin to what? Release words. Amen. Now, as you begin to release words and begin to praise God for what you're believing for, then you begin to what? Internalize. So you have the verbalization stage of meditation. Everybody said the verbalization.
Verbalization.
You got to speak the word. As you begin to speak the word, then you're going to begin to what? Visualize and begin to what? See yourself as what? God sees you. And you're not going to see. Now, Caleb and Joshua, when they came back with their report, what did they say?
We are well able.
Amen. They are what? They're meat for us. They ain't got a chance. Amen. We are. God has already what? Spoken. The land is ours. No problem. Let's go for it. But these 10 spies, the word of God had what? Kicked in. And they said, no, we better be saved. Amen. Praise God. So they saw themselves inferior. And that's what happens when the word of God hasn't really taken hold of your thought process. Okay, now, let me just finish this. It's affecting in you, change. It's affecting, changing, it's changing you on the inside. It's deprogramming you and painting a new picture of you inwardly. Everybody say, a new picture. Amen. The word of God can paint a new picture of you on the inside. How many know what I mean?
Yes.
Amen. And it sees you as being what? Able. Yes. Seeing you as being sufficient, not in yourself, but your sufficiency is what? It's of God. Amen. Seeing that God is what? Working in you, and He's effectually working in all of them that's what? Believing. So the Word of God has the ability what? To paint a new picture of you. How many want a new picture painted of you, painted on, amen, on the inside of you? How many want to see yourself as God sees you?
Amen.
Amen. How many want to see yourself as being well able to take possessions of the things that God, amen, has actually, amen, released into our lives? Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. All right. I'm going to close out, but the fourth point that we don't have time to share would be your experience. The things that you actually experience in life probably has more effect on you than the environment. Y'all might think about this. Your credible authority figures, repetitious information, the facto that has most impact on the way you think and believe is going to be things that you experience. All right, how many believe that? They're going to have more effect on you than any other thing. Now, this includes the devastation from life experiences, which has damaged us emotionally and has caused mental strongholds to develop, such as some people have gone through rape, rejection, no love in home, parents talking down to you, and physical abuse. No father figure, alcoholic and dope head parents, deserted by parents, those who lost parents at early age, non-parental support and motivation, parents who lived in adultery and sin, those who got arrested or was in prison, had an addiction, had an abortion, committed fornication and adultery. These are the experiences that will impact us a lot more than the environment, or credible authority figures, or either repetitious. Now, usually when people are impacted by these negative life experiences, it goes very, very, very deep. How many can they say amen?
Amen.
Amen. So next week we'll show you how, since experiences plays the most important role in our mind renewing process, then we'll tell you what experiences that we can have with the Lord that will actually, amen, impact our lives and enable the process of renewing the mind to become, praise God, a reality in our life. And there are certain experiences that we can have with the Lord that can undo everything that we've been through, everything that we have experienced. How many believe that? Bible says where sin has abounded, grace doth what?
Much more.
Much more abound. How many believe that an experience with God can overrule, override any kind of physical experience that we have encountered in our lifetime and actually put us on the road to what? Full recovery and complete victory. We'll go over that next week. Amen. This is kind of involved, but it really kind of locates us and let us know exactly where we are in terms and why we are there in terms of the things that we believe. Amen. Okay, will this help them?
Yeah.
Let's go. All right. Praise God. All right, let us all stand. We're going to praise God. Hallelujah. Father, tonight we thank you, Lord, for a revelation of the things that have contributed to the way that we think and the way that we believe. Father, knowing that these things, these factors that we mentioned tonight, are responsible for the level of belief and the quality of belief that we have. Father, we know that there are some changes that we can make and there are some factors that we can involve.